Chapter 3. Following Ray. It wasn't like I was destitute. The rent at the American Hotel was a mere $450 a month. I had the biggest room in the whole building, a third floor walk-up. It was a mini loft of sorts. It was one big open space and a small electric kitchen that I had set up in an adjoining room. It had four large windows that wrapped around the perimeter of the apartment, catching light throughout the morning and afternoon. You could see City Hall and the old Hall of Justice Jail to the west, and the Angeles Crest mountain range out beyond Union Station to the northeast. Of the six rooms I had there over the years, it was the best one yet. The others were not much bigger than a jail cell. The bathrooms and showers were down the hall on either end of the hallway, two to each floor. They were cleaned every day by a janitor, Juan Carlos. As the story goes, he was sitting in the back seat of a car full of illegals out in front of the building early one morning. They were drunk and hollering at each other in Spanish and laughing. When the manager of the hotel at the time stuck his head in the window of the car and said, "One of you amigos looking for a job? Trabajo?" Juan Carlos raised his hand first and had from that day forth been the janitor of the American Hotel for going on 25 years. He lived on the first floor in one of the smaller rooms. He installed a plush red carpet and hung thick matching curtains on the window. When the afternoon sun hit them, it made the light in the room a hot Mexican red. He'd rise early in the morning before the sun, take the garbage out at the end of the hallways from all four floors. Then he'd mop the floors in the bathrooms and showers with a bleach soap solution, clean the toilets, and then sweep the hallways. When his work was done, he'd walk down to the Grand Central Market on 3rd and Broadway, buy a carne de cabra, goat meat burrito, a fifth of tequila, and a six-pack of Pacifico, bring it back to the hotel, eat and drink in his bed, then fall fast asleep for the rest of the afternoon. It might seem strange that I knew so much about his daily routine, but all one had to do is peer through his open door, because most times, many of the residents had their doors propped open. We'd wander from room to room, bottles or food or drugs in hand to share and imbibe together. Some people strewn pixie lights over their doorways or across their walls, where collages and paintings hung, or photographs, or sculptures, or wood carvings. Incense burned and candles lit their dark corners and small spaces, playing guitar and singing together, the windows covered in colored gels or thick tapestries, dimming and stifling the nagging sun. We'd pass the bottle or the joint or the occasional powder and chat and laugh in the soft light of nothing much to do. We were just a bunch of lost spirits, painters, musicians, poets, outlaws, and outliers. Some of us mad, not fit for employment, for family life, for jails or mental hospitals. The American was a last bastion for our ilk, a bit of cheap and brittle shelter for cheap and brittle souls. It slowed the fractures, the gutting, the carving the knife of our lives scarred us with. It was the kind of place that, if you landed there, you could easily find yourself planted for years, decades in many cases. There was Barney, for instance. He had lived there since the late 50s. He was an old Mexican gent, raised over the bridge in Boyle Heights. He was small, about 5'2", and was an ex-boxer. He told me many a story of the days when he and his compadres, while playing in the streets, most just 14 or 15 years of age, would be recruited to box in undercard bouts for Jack Dempsey or Maxie Rosenblum fights. He said the promoters would pay them in meat. They would hand over paper sacks of skirt steak or a live chicken to bring home to their families. That was it. They would walk in their kitchen door to their mothers and fathers, bloodied, bruised, and exhausted, with food to feed their families for a couple days, heroic and lavished in the pride of their loved ones. There was Michelle and Jean-Philippe. They had a double, one of the few in the building. One room acted as their living room, the walls plastered in show flyers, rock posters, and portraits that Michelle painted. Jean-Philippe, dressed like a dastardly villain from a silent-era melodrama, complete with a curly mustache, top hat, and cape. Michelle wore tattered old poodle skirts and wrapped flower-patterned scarves around her dishwater blonde hair. She was constantly drunk and rambling odd turns of phrase. She had a quick and extremely sharp wit in spite of her drunkenness. They had an old bed with a Baroque antique wood-carved headboard that Michelle scotch-taped old black-and-white photo booth strips of her and Jean-Philippe in Coney Island and at the old Pike in Long Beach. She tied dead, dried bundles of roses to the banister with red ribbon, and they would read together in bed by soft lamplight, drinking absinthe and smoking joints laced with opium. There was TV Terry. Terry had an encyclopedic knowledge of, among many subjects, everything about television and film. He was slight and spry with a wild Beethoven-esque frock of white hair and crystal blue eyes. His apartment housed a plethora of VHS tapes of obscure TV classics, cartoons, and exploitation films, which he regularly showcased at the art collective across the street from the hotel. He'd set up folding chairs, couches, and old recliners, and project the videos on a big screen. He served beer and popcorn and other concessions. We'd smoke joints and watch old movies as if we were relaxing in our own living rooms. One guest who stayed there very briefly was living out some kind of Franz Kafka fantasy. He was tall, thin, bald-headed, and wore big fluorescent yellow glasses that gave him a bug-like appearance. He was very quiet most of the time, though when spoken to was very quick-tempered and venomous. When you passed him on the stairs, he would turn to the wall in a corner and hide his face, his long fingers pressed up against it, like a scared spider clinging there until you passed. He lived in the smallest room in the whole building. I was passing his door one day when he was leaving, and I saw that all he had inside was a mat on the floor, a milk crate to sit on, and a small portable radio. His few clothes hung in a canvas bag on a hook nailed to the wall. I'd hear him in there while passing his door, moaning, wailing, hissing, laughing maniacally at other times. He made you wonder just when it was he was going to snap and hurt someone. I'd see him out of the bathroom window some late nights while taking a piss. He'd be jogging in small, careful strides along the sidewalk, with a resentful grimace on his face, as if he were running over nails with every step. The look of a doomed soul lurked in his eyes, behind those buggy yellow glasses of his. There was Stevie Casual, the quintessential Southern California beach bum, stoner, always tan, bleach blonde hair, puka shells around his sun-colored neck, golf visor over his bloodshot eyes, grinning a blissful smile, mumbling, unintelligible most times, but always good-spirited and playful, never a negative word. He was a grip on motion pictures, mostly non-union B-movies, porn sometimes. He was alone mostly, content to smoke weed in his room and strum his guitar and chant his Buddhist mantras. The hotel was built in 1905 and owned and operated by the only black police officer in the whole LAPD, only the second black man to serve in the whole history of the force at that point in time. It was originally a hotel for black travelers passing through town. Los Angeles housing was restricted in those days. Musicians, pimps, prostitutes, even a freak show attraction and a traveling circus lived there at one time. He was a giant standing 8.5 feet tall. It had a notorious reputation from day one as a sometimes brothel, gambling parlor, and drug den. The policeman sold the hotel to one of the most notorious gangsters in the city at the time, which only perpetuated its reputation and subsequent goings-on. People from all over the world would drift through, from France, Brazil, Spain, Japan. There were several Japanese. They were used to the small Spartan spaces, and the hotel stood just on the other side of Alameda from Little Tokyo, so they felt at home there. Back in the late 30s, the hotel was almost entirely Japanese, in fact. That is, until World War II, when most of the residents there and throughout California were forced out of their homes and into internment camps. A German girl, Astrid, came to stay for a time. She had a roundish apple head, blonde hair, cropped short, large breasts, corn-fed, warm alabaster skin, and piercing blue eyes that were very intense. She had the same expression on her face every time I saw her. It was blank, detached, and joyless. She spoke in a very terse, direct, and unnervingly honest way. There was no ease in her words or demeanor. Somehow, she got word of how easy it was to procure drugs in the neighborhood and started into a vicious addiction to methamphetamine. There was a scrapyard that sat in an alleyway across 4th Street. There was a corrugated fence with Constantine wire splayed over the top to keep out thieves. There was a small hole on one end of the fence. The word around the campfire was that all one had to do is go up to the hole, rap on the fence, and someone on the other side would ask you what you were looking for. And I mean just about anything. Speed, heroin, pills, spikes, marijuana, acid, mescaline, coke, you name it. You'd place your order, stick your money in the hole, and the person on the other side would fill your prescription. It was as easy as that, and from what I was told, very consistent and reliable. As far as I know, no one who ever went there walked away empty-handed. Astrid started visiting the hole every day, then twice a day. Before long, she had sold everything she had, including her bed. She didn't need a bed anyway. She would be up for days on end. I'd see her in the bathroom on the first floor, glaring into the mirror over the sink, picking away at her face, which was a Germanic, milky, smooth white. I'd see her in there every time I was coming or going. So one day, I went so far as to ask her what it was she was picking at. She turned to me with her blank blue eyes and said, "There are little bugs in my room. They bury themselves in my face when I doze off. They can lay eggs in your skin if you don't get them out." She would claw away until there were big, oozing sores on her chin and cheeks. She would peel them back further and further. They were yellow with pus and red around the edges. One night when I was coming in from work, I saw Astrid in the back of a police car. Blue eyes, expressionless, cheeks wet with pus, handcuffed, grinding her teeth. She was saying something to me through the window of the cop car. I couldn't hear her voice or make out her words. She grinded and spat and grit her teeth, mouthing ugly words, probably in German. Her breathing looked shallow and panicked. I turned away, sadly, and went up the stairs to my room. I never saw her again. And below us on the ground floor of the hotel, spray-painted walls, smelling of stale beer and piss, dark and dingy, windowless, lit with strange yellow lamps and Christmas lights, littered here and there with old couches and vinyl booths, was Al's Bar. In Barney's day, when he first moved in back in the 50s, Al's was an Italian restaurant and wine bar. The way Barney told it, a gang of mafiosos would frequent the place. They were so rowdy and bloodthirsty that the other patrons were too scared to eat there, so they went out of business. Then it was a sort of truck stop cafe for the truckers who would pick up and deliver tires from the tire treading factories that surrounded the area. That's where the name of our street, Traction, came from. They stopped serving food and kept it from then on a saloon. The hotel was basically a flophouse throughout the 50s and 60s for middle-aged drifters and bums who had nowhere else to go. Then in the mid-70s, a local artist and entrepreneur named Mark Kreisel bought the building and turned Al's into a hangout for local artists and live music venue. Over the subsequent years, just about every punk, new wave, rockabilly, metal, or any other type of band you could come up with played the Al's Bar stage, including my own. Next to Al's on the corner of the ground floor of the hotel was Bloom's General Store. It had cigarettes, magazines, candy bars, chips, and a rather well-realized humidor with expensive cigars from around the globe. There was a video rental in the back of the store with a fine, sophisticated selection of art films, foreign, B-movies, black exploitation, westerns, and classics. Next to Bloom's was a soul food restaurant called the Soul Folks Cafe. The food was mediocre at best, and the service was slow, almost non-existent, in fact. The waitresses, who also acted as cooks, bussers, and dishwashers, were often too busy smoking blunts in the patio out behind the kitchen to be bothered by pesky customers waiting for their food. They wore long, flowing African print dresses, and their dreadlocks tied back in matching scarves, their eyes a grinning, carefree red. They had a pretty surefire method of stymieing their patrons' frustrations, though. They'd cruise up to your table with a fat blunt and would coo, "Sorry your food is taking so long, baby. Why don't you come in the back and burn down this lovely ganja with us?" Which we would typically take them up on enthusiastically. The sentiment would then turn from, "Where the hell are my chicken and collard greens, goddammit?" to, "Whatevs. The food will come out at some point. Fuck it. Let me get another drag on that, baby." All the artists and freaks gathered there every morning on the corner of Traction and Hewitt in front of Bloom's General Store, sitting at the tables outside the Soul Folks Cafe, nursing hangovers from the previous night's debauchery, drinking strong coffee, eating runny eggs and overcooked bacon, smoking joints, gossiping, and poring over the morning paper. It was our little family of broken misfits, making our way in the dawn's early light. The Arts District family. The American Hotel family. I found myself there because of Ray. Raymond Vaughn was 2.5 years older than me. I remember the very first day I saw him. He was squatting down in front of the Improv Comedy Club on Melrose Avenue smoking a cigarette. I was working there on the phones booking shows. I was 19. The first thing that hit my brain was, holy shit. Why is James Spader smoking a cigarette in front of the Improv at 9 o'clock in the morning? Because that is exactly who Ray looked like. A 1987 James Spader in less than zero. Tall, handsome, blonde, moody, slightly lonely, slightly menacing, slightly wily, slightly evil. Very interesting. As I walked through the front door, we gave each other a slight nod. It turned out that Ray had just gotten hired as a booker as well. He worked on the phones during the day there at the Hollywood Improv, and then worked as a doorman at the Santa Monica Improv at night, tearing tickets and chasing away homeless beggars who were pestering our guests for change. That morning, Bud Friedman, who founded the Improv, sent Ray and I out with flyers to canvass the UCLA campus for patrons to attend a free taping of the A&E's Evening at the Improv television show. It was the club's bread and butter at the time, and we spent all week, every week, trying to wrangle a full house for the showcase. Bud came into the phone room with a slightly annoyed look on his face, annoyed that he had to speak or even look at one of his lowly subordinates. He pointed at me and gruffly spat, You drive a car, right? I nodded. Take these flyers and hand them out to the students and faculty at UCLA. Go now, quickly. The show needs to be packed, Bud grunted. And you go with him, he exclaimed, pointing at Ray. Ray followed me out to the car. He didn't say a word as we walked down the street to where I was parked. Usually, upon meeting someone new, there were pleasantries exchanged. The old getting-to-know-you banter you offer up and receive when being tasked to do something, like being made to work together for the day. Especially at such a menial task as this mission, especially for the first time. There was none of that, at least from Ray. I rambled on uncomfortably, trying to make small talk. We rode along in the overcast morning air. Ray sat quietly, rubbing his eyes and yawning, staring straight ahead and paying close attention to the road, almost as if he were the one driving. We found a place to park and walked across the campus. We found a coffee stand, and I offered to buy Ray a cup. He softened up a bit then and warmly thanked me. I was taken aback by the warmth and tenor of his voice when he spoke. It was deep, and his enunciation was concise, and at the same time fluid, easy, and sure. Almost out of time, as was seemingly everything about him. He wore a stingy brim hat like a jazz musician on the cover of Downbeat magazine in the 50s, gold-rimmed glasses, a black button-down shirt with the sleeves rolled up, suspenders holding up his stovepipe pants and Stacy Adams wingtips, His slender frame wore the accoutrements well. It didn't feel like a put-on, though. It was all very natural. He carried himself with a stately elegance. He was very graceful and cool. We sat in the brisk morning air drinking coffee and smoking Ray's French filterless cigarettes. Ray, still stoic, quiet, pored over the LA Weekly. That's where I learned about the LA Weekly, in fact, from Ray. I had seen it in piles in front of record stores on Melrose and in magazine stands around Hollywood Boulevard, but never bothered to pick one up. The Weekly is great, man. It just has little tidbits. Where bands are playing, good restaurant reviews, movies, and Matt Groening's life in hell is a laugh riot, too. I picked up my own copy off the pile sitting next to the coffee stand and flipped through, absorbing immediately what it was that Ray found so interesting about it all. I couldn't remember a time before then that I had even glanced at a newspaper for more than a minute or two, funny as that might sound. They just never interest me. We left the flyer sitting in a pile next to the weeklies and decided to spend the rest of the day ogling beautiful college girls and fucking off. The campus was beautiful. The affluent and lush hillside homes of Brentwood surrounded it at every vista. The students all seemed well-fed and rested and at ease as they strolled from class to class across the quad. Ray and I sat on a bench under an old tree, and he told me his life story. He told me that he never knew his mother, that his father told him that she didn't want him, so she left. His father was quite old when he was born, about 50. He said he never lived in one place for more than a year or so. His father dragged him from town to town across the Southwest. Albuquerque, Salt Lake City, Bullhead City, St. George, Utah, Phoenix. One trailer park, one run-down dingbat, one transient motel after another. His father would work as a janitor in a high school or in a packing plant in some shithole desert town to be able to feed and clothe his young son. He said that once, when living in Bowie, Arizona, his father bought him a dirt bike, a little 200cc Yamaha. He was riding it across some trails out in the hills when he came hauling ass over a mound into a giant ditch. He broke his leg badly in two places and was bedridden for 9 months. They didn't have a TV, but his father was working at a community college as a custodian in the school library and would bring Ray books to read every day after work. That's when Ray discovered his love for reading and his innate ability to absorb and comprehend great works with terrific ease and speed. He could read a book a day, or even two, and often did. At the tender age of 11 years old, he was already devouring Hemingway, J.D. Salinger, Henry Miller, Arthur Rimbaud, and Dostoevsky. I shit you not. His vernacular was brilliant, wavering between obscure beat poet street jive and an expansive array of gorgeous words. His vocabulary seemed endless and expertly utilized. It was a pleasure listening to him speak. He went on to explain that he suspected that his father had actually kidnapped him, that they kept moving around the way they did to elude authorities that might want to separate them. When Ray turned 12, they moved into a trailer on the edge of one of the largest pine forests in North America, in Flagstaff, Arizona. His father bought him a rifle and a German shepherd, who he named Rosie. He and his dog would spend summer afternoons strolling through the woods, hunting small birds and squirrels. He joined the Boy Scouts, started a paper route, and his father found work at Northern Arizona University. They felt like they might have finally found a place to settle for a while. Ray was quite happy. Then one day, Ray came home to find that his newspapers were sitting on the front porch. They weren't folded and ready for delivery, something his father always helped him with while Ray was at his Boy Scout meetings after school. He called out to his father, but there was no answer. He went into his room and found his father on the bed. He had died of a heart attack. Ray, in shock, staggered out of the trailer and down the road on foot to find help. Some neighbors found him wandering in the dark with a blank, far-off look on his pale face. Ray became a ward of the court then, He didn't know where his mother was or if she was even alive. The courts couldn't find her either. It was just a glimmer of good luck in a bad situation that found Ray with some modicum of support. His father had known that his health was failing. He kept it from Ray as to not worry him. But while they were staying in St. George, Utah, Ray's father had befriended a Mormon family called the Johnsons and asked them if they would take care of Ray should anything happen to him. They agreed and even signed a contract with Ray's father to solidify their commitment. Upon getting word of his death, the family came to Flagstaff, papers in hand, to take Ray with them, to raise them as one of their own. Not at all uncommon in the Mormon community. The Johnsons were devout and good people. They were big, well-fed, overweight in fact, stout, short, and round. They were well-to-do and had a fridge full of food in the kitchen, a pantry filled to the brim with cookies, chips, crackers, candy, and bread, a large freezer in the garage full of steaks, pork chops, sides of bacon, whole chickens, gallons of ice cream, and stacks of TV dinners, something that Ray just wasn't used to. He and his father got by on very little, and Ray was thin as a pin. His ribs were visible, and he had extra notches that he carved into all his belts with a pocket knife. His hair was unkempt and wild, a bowl cut his father gave him. He was a feral little rascal to boot, hyperactive in mind and body. He took full advantage of the spoils of his new surroundings, eating like he never had before, piling in pot roasts, casseroles, and desserts the Johnsons were privy to daily. Mrs. Johnson, who never seemed to like Ray much, would make snide little comments. "Goodness gracious, Ray, be careful with all that cake and ice cream. You don't want to get fat." Ray, already much brighter than most of the adults he came in contact with, and twice as clever, and 10 times the smartass, would simply lift his shirt to expose his prominent rib cage, while still stuffing his face with the other hand, not missing a beat, leaving Mrs. Johnson with a resentful glare pointed at him from her bloated, blotchy face. He stayed with the Johnsons for 4 years, becoming a full Eagle Scout in the meantime, making stellar marks in school, working in a tile-cutting plant, saving enough money to buy a motorcycle which he dubbed the Dark Horse, running on the cross-country team, and even finding romance for the first time. He met Mary his freshman year. She was a senior and was the personification of southwestern perfection. Blonde, golden tan, blue eyes, thick, tight, full-breasted, devilish smile, sharp as a tack, popular, scholarly and quick-witted, perfectly suited for Ray. He said when they met, he could hardly speak without stuttering. She made his otherwise cool and unflappable demeanor wilt under her charms. When he turned 16, some friends invited him to a Judas Priest concert in nearby Las Vegas. He told the Johnsons that he was spending the night out camping with some friends from his Eagle Scout troop, as he was certain they wouldn't approve of such an outing. They were strict Mormons and thought that that kind of music was demonic and indulgent. But Ray was no Mormon. They insisted on taking him to temple, and he had to attend school and community events with Mormon kids in his neighborhood. But Ray was too smart, too free-thinking, and too wild to buy their bullshit. He put on a cooperative facade and appreciation for the Johnsons taking him in and caring for him. But he just went through the motions, never believing even for a second in any of their dogma. He went to the concert with his buddies, drank beer for the first time, got bored with the music, and went back to his friend's van to sleep. Pretty uneventful and definitely far from a demonic row. When he got home the next morning, the Johnsons were waiting on their front porch with Ray's belongings packed in a duffel bag, sitting on the stairs. They had called one of his friends he said he was going camping with to ask if he needed any money for food or supplies. The kid didn't know what they were talking about, and upon further investigation and questioning some of Ray's other friends, they found out that he had gone to the concert. "We don't tolerate liars in this community, especially ones that listen to the devil's music. You go. Go out into the world on your own. Leave this house of the Lord and never come back. Mrs. Johnson exclaimed, probably thinking he would spend a night or two in the streets and would come back with his tail between his legs, ready to behave. With that, Ray Cooley picked up the duffel bag, strapped it onto his motorcycle, threw on his leather jacket, lit a cigarette, never looked back to say sorry or goodbye, and rode off into the desert. He never saw the Johnsons again. Not ever. He rode around the outskirts of town looking for shelter. He didn't want to impose on his friends for a place to stay. He was bound and determined to make his way on his own. He rode down a trail off the main road and came upon a dried lake bed. In the center of the lake, sunk down in the dirt, was an old sailboat, stranded there, leaning slightly, dilapidated and abandoned. He climbed on and opened the hatch into the cabin below deck. It had a bed, a table mounted to the floor, and a small closet. He moved his stuff in and hid his motorbike out of sight. He camped out there for a whole month. The Johnsons never came to the school to check up on him, probably out of embarrassment, not fulfilling their godly duties as Mormons, as foster parents, and kicking him out for no good reason. He went to the school and asked to take his GED and, of course, pass with flying colors. His girlfriend Mary had been taking acting and dancing lessons since she was a kid. When she graduated, she auditioned for a theater conservatory in L.A. and was accepted. Ray, mad about her and ready to follow her to the ends of the earth, decided he would come out west with her. She was ecstatic. She came out ahead of him to get enrolled in classes and found an apartment for them on Sunset Boulevard in La Cienega, right above the Pink Dot liquor store and grocery delivery. Ray got on his bike a few weeks later and rode out of the high desert into the L.A. basin, young, free, bright, ambitious, and in love. Ray and I became fast friends from that point on. We would take lunch breaks together, sneaking out behind the club to smoke joints and sip tequila from a flask. After work one day, we were sitting at a bar having a drink. That was the first day I met Mary. While Ray was a good-looking guy, he was also seemingly shy, not one to flirt with a woman or even speak to one. He kept to himself mostly and wouldn't even engage in banter about women in rude and crass ways with the guys, bragging about their sexual exploits and desires. So I was rather shocked upon seeing Mary, who rolled up behind Ray on a pair of roller skates, obscenely dressed in short shorts, her thick, perfect ass filling them out, her full breasts, braless, covered only by a tight, white, sheer wife beater, nipples pronounced and excited. She put her hands over his eyes and cooed, "Guess who, you sexy fucker?" She smelt of booze. I could smell her from where I sat. Drunk, on roller skates, riding across town to see Ray, who barely moved or even looked up from his newspaper on the bar to acknowledge her. She wrapped herself around him, pulling his face away from his reading, to plant a big, wet kiss on him. She was stunningly beautiful. The other guys at the bar fell silent, jaws hitting the floor. It became apparent that Ray was not only a straight-up lady killer, but one of the highest order. Ray and Mary were very much in love, but their relationship was tumultuous. Mary was jealous and aware of Ray's allure to other women. She would get pissed and kick him out of their apartment. Ray would come stay with me then. I had a studio apartment on Franklin Avenue in La Brea at the foot of the Hollywood Hills. Ray and I would have grand times, lazing around the pad, rolling joints, drinking red stripe beers, listening to records, and talking about books. That's when Ray turned me on to Tom Waits and Leonard Cohen, and to the holy triumvirate of William S. Burroughs, Jack Kerouac, and Allen Ginsberg. He gave me a book on Burroughs called Literary Outlaw that covered the Beat Generation's beginnings leading up to the punk rock scene in New York in the early 70s. I read it voraciously, reading then everything the Beats wrote, Junkie, On the Road, Howl, Dharma Bums, Queer, Naked Lunch, and the like. And as I got to know those stories and the people who wrote them, I began to get who and why Ray was who he was. He was a bit of William Burroughs, stately, sharply dressed, sardonic, like an old man in a young man's body. But he was also my Neil Cassidy, jive, streetwise, rhythmic, on the move, an inspiration, a muse. We'd sit up all night on mushrooms, waxing poetic, gazing out the window at the Santa Ana windswept dawn rising over the Japanese pines, swaying in the garden of Yamashiro restaurant at the top of the hill. I saved some money and bought a white 1981 Vespa Piaggio P200E Italian scooter. Ray liked it so much, he sold the dark horse and bought his own in red. We would drop acid and drink gin and go for rides up in the hills along Mulholland, taking fast turns through its many curves and bends, hooting at coyotes running alongside us through the brush, pulling off at the top of Outpost Road to look out over the skyline of the city with LSD eyes and pondered the wonderment of our existence. We were spies, witnessing the city with rapture, agents of cool. Over the next couple years, I learned much from Ray. He was like the big brother I never had. We had many adventures together and raised a lot of cane. Ray got tired of the constant bickering and fights him and Mary were always getting into, and having to crash at my place every time she kicked him out, so he decided it was time to find his own place. One night he asked me if I wanted to take a ride downtown to check out a bar. I followed Ray down Sunset to where it meets Alameda at Olvera Street, then down to the corner of Traction and Hewitt. The street was empty but for a few cars and a couple of bums sleeping on the sidewalk. As we parked our bikes, Ray looked at me and said, "What do you think, man? This is it. Am I right?" "This is what?" I thought to myself, peering up into the dimly lit windows of the hotel. We went into Al's and ordered two pints. Some old-timers were at the pool table shooting a game. The walls were layered over in show flyers, bamboo facade, wheat paste, and graffiti. There was a dank, damp, dungeon-like smell in the air. The place filled you with a history, a ghostly past of hard-fought lives and hard-fought nights of revelry. I knew then what Ray meant. This was it. This is where we were going to make our home.